Bhaktapad create controversy over whether cults serve any higher purpose at all or are just breeding grounds for theft, fraud, illegal activity. Joining me now, Larry Shin. He's author of The Dark Lord, Cult Images and the Hare Krishna in America. We're also joined in New York by Herbert Rosedale, attorney and president of the American Family Foundation. We'll get to Herbert in a moment. Larry, this book's concept is what?
Well, essentially, Larry, back in 1980, I'd already studied the Krishna movement in India for about 15 years at that point, and was curious to know whether the American form, the Hare Krishnas as they're often called, ISKCON, in fact was reasonably authentic relative to its Indian form. I spent about 4.5 months living in 14 different Krishna temples in the United States, but then also in India. Mm-hmm. That is, a Krishna, American Krishna temples in India.
Is it very different?
No. Not in most places, but the thing that I learned is it's hard to generalize. And in fact, what you just heard in the repartee between the two swamis suggests that ISKCON is anything but of a single piece. During that time, what I discovered was that there were a lot of people who, in fact, were trying to say that all the cults are the same. Not only just all of ISKCON is the same, but all the cults are the same, and they're also all dangerous. It's that disparateness, that sense that, in fact, that wasn't true, that's not what I was seeing when I went to these various Christian temples, that caused me to study the anti-cult movement as well. In fact, I visited Western Massachusetts, I interviewed John Clark of the American Family Foundation, I've interviewed people from CAN, the Cult Awareness Network.
People vocally opposed to
cults. Vocally opposed to the cults, to try to get some sense of why they were making the claim that all cults seem to be led by a greedy guru who somehow brings under his or her control a group of people who then are, quote, brainwashed and who have to be deprogrammed to be gotten out.
This is all part of the Jones-Guyana thing, right? I mean, that's ignited all the fear.
It's what I call in my book the Jonestown Syndrome.
Okay. What do you mean by the Dark Lord? Why that title?
Well, it's meant to be in a double entendre. That is, on the one hand, Krishna in Sanskrit means the dark-skinned one, the black one, as black as a dark storm cloud. Hence, his images quite often are coal black. So on the one hand, it's descriptive. On the other hand, the cult, anti-cult people in America would have us believe that all the cults, but also, of course, then the Krishnas, are demonic. They're evil. They're dark. And hence the double entendre.
Is this a book of reportage, or are you winding up with a stand here that some cults are okay, some aren't, and the American Family Foundation, in taking a stand against all of them, is wrong?
Well, you're putting words in my mouth, but let me...
Let's do it as a question. Is it reportage only?
No. It's more than reportage. It's interpretive. It's not meant to be simply normative. That is, it's interpretive in the sense of saying, given all this information, to what extent are the cult stereotypes of the anti-cultists true or not? Mm-hmm. And I take each chapter and look at brainwashing, the notion of people giving up their free will, what deprogramming is all about, whether we really have deprogramming is a special phenomenon. In any case, in each case then, I try to determine to what extent the Krishnas match that description. And I conclude finally, they don't, but some segments of them approximate it. Hence, there's a whole range.
Okay, as we discovered in the first half hour.
Exactly.
Before we talk to Herbert, what do you make of the opening dispute? What do you make of Bhaktapad?
Well, I met Bhaktapad back in 1981. I visited New Vrindavan for about 10 days, interviewed 15, 18 devotees there for about 3 hours each. Went back in 1985 and spent about 2 weeks there, and then went back in the in January of 1988. So I've been there three different times.
And?
What I make of this, Larry, is that I think New Vrindavan has affected this isolation. The fact that it's been under one single guru the whole time, all 20 years, has in fact, I think, given the Swami an inflated sense of his power. And I think that as I listened to some of the senior devotees who've now abandoned him and have left the community far smaller than the number he reported to you, I
not
suspect...
Not 400 and thousands across America.
I don't think so. Now, thousands across America, I don't know. What I know is that the community is much less than 100.
Is this trial a smokescreen, or is he in big trouble?
I think he's in big trouble, but I don't know. That's for the court to decide. I don't have any special privileged information to suggest.
But you do think he got too big, stayed too long at the fair?
I think so.
Okay.
And in fact, we know some of the charges against the community are true.
And the gentleman who called in, do you know him too?
I know him quite well.
Do you hold him in high regard?
Considerably higher regard, partly because in his case he's worked within the system to listen to his god brothers' criticisms, and although he's now, of course, has a position of power himself, but I think he's far less at the center personally than someone like Bucky Buck.
Herbert Rosedale is attorney and president of the American Family Foundation. He's with us in New York. Herbert, if the definition of cults is any group gathering together with a common belief, that would make any religion a cult. So how are you defining it?
First of all, I think we could spend an enormous time, as you have here, setting up straw men which have no basis in reality. We're not talking about a definition of a cult. We are talking about a particular kind of destructive behavior. And when a group under the control of a totalistic leader engages in destructive behavior which does unconsented harm to those people who participate in it, then we are talking about a destructive cult. And I have no idea whatsoever, being familiar with the American Family Foundation and CAN and other of these groups that are often lumped in the, quote, anti-cult movement, of any group or individual affiliated with that group who has ever said that all cults are alike. No more than that all people are alike, or all writers, or all books are alike. I deal with people individually. I have dealt with ex-members of the Hare Krishna group. I have spoken to them about their experiences. I do not find them benevolent, unconsented to experiences which evidence a love, an affection, and an outlook for peace, whether those are under the particular Swami or the new group using the name Islam.
Herbert, therefore, are you saying that all Hare Krishnas are there something wrong, or are you saying some? Because you said you're not saying all. Are you saying?
What I am saying is that it is my belief that the Hare Krishna group utilizes deceit and manipulation in the introduction of people into joining the group.
That's
it
all
uses
Hare
manipulative
Krishna
tactics
group
to make them stay.
Okay. So in the case of the Hare Krishnas, you are lumping. They all do that.
No, they do that as a group. I am not saying that each person who joins has gone through an identical experience, or that each person who joins is necessarily adversely affected. If only some are, and they did not consent to take that risk, then that is a destructive organization.
Well, then, what if I join a church? What if I join the Jewish church and I hear somebody preaching something and I hit people who eat pork? Would you then condemn the whole Jewish faith because I hit people who eat pork because my rabbi told me pork's bad?
No, I did not say anything like that.
Why not? I did something dangerous.
If a person injures another person, he has no right to use a religious motivation for the justification for his conduct.
So you're not blaming the Krishnas, you're blaming the act.
It is the act which is wrong, which is sought to be punished.
Let me get a break and we'll come right back with Larry Shin, who, by the way, is Vice President of Academic Affairs at Bucknell University and is author of The Dark Lord, and Herbert Rosedale, attorney and president of the American Family Foundation. First, these words.